I'm gonna get lit up when the lights go up in London.
Tally-ho, pip-pip, and how's your father? Joolz Guides here, and today I shall mostly be wandering around London talking about English language idioms and why we say them, as well as pointing out some tenuous links dotted around London. Now, have you ever heard the expression, a white elephant? Now, a white elephant is something which is a kind of burden, something that's very expensive, usually a big grand undertaking by the government or something, for example. They might say, oh, that garden bridge that they want to build, it costs so much money, that's a bit of a white elephant. Or, why are they spending all that money on that big railway, the HS2, going all the way up to Birmingham? What are they wasting their money on that white elephant for? Now, in order to understand why they call that a white elephant, we have to go back to old Siam, back in Southeast Asia in the 19th century, where white elephants were, and probably still are, pretty rare. If a monarch had a white elephant, he was a particularly powerful, just monarch who ruled with a fair but stern hand. And of course, if you had done something nice for the king, sometimes he'd want to reward you, and he might say, well, why don't you have one of my white elephants? And of course, you couldn't refuse this gift from the king, but it was a terrible expensive and difficult thing to maintain, and only a white elephant could ruin a man. In fact, sometimes if the king didn't like you, he might deliberately give you a white elephant just so that he could make you bankrupt. And so owning these white elephants became a bit of a burden and a terribly expensive waste of time, which is why we use it to describe big undertakings and waste of time, expensive building projects. And my tenuous link to this building behind me, which is in Camden Town on the corner of Kentish Town Road and Hawley Crescent, is that this used to be the Camden Brewery, and their trademark was an elephant's head. Back in the 19th century, there was a brewery architect called William Brandford. I didn't know such people existed, but they did apparently, and he designed this building here for the Camden Brewery. And he thought it would be a good idea to incorporate the trademark of the elephant's head, because Elephant Pale Ale was one of the most popular beers, and a part of the brewery was actually, I believe, the Elephant's Head pub, which is around the corner there, where a lot of rockabilly's drinking now, I think. I've never actually been there myself, but I believe that Amy Winehouse has, amongst others. I mean, she probably has. She's drank in most places around Camden.
I'm gonna get so lit up, I'll be visible for life.
Now, have you ever been passed from pillar to post? Being passed from pillar to post means, for example, if you call up the council and you said, sorry, there's some workmen outside and they've left some rubbish outside my house. Could you come and sort it out for me? And then they say, oh, well, sorry, we've got to put you through to the rubbish clearance department. So they put you through to the rubbish clearance department, and then they say, oh, no, it's not the rubbish department you need the recycling department, and then they put you through to somebody else, and they keep doing this to you all day, and in the end you get very fed up and you say, oh gosh, they were passing me from pillar to post all day. Now, one explanation of this phrase is that it comes from being passed from pillory to post, and the pillory was a punishment used for more minor crimes like lying, cheating, being homosexual. They'd put your hands and your head into the pillory, and people would come and chuck rotten fruit at you and other items. One of the pillories was right at the end of Fleet Street in Trafalgar Square. And if they wanted to teach you a really good lesson, they'd take you out of the pillory and take you over to the whipping post with people harassing you in the street all the way there and give you a damn good thrashing, hence from pillory to post. Now, my tenuous link for this idiom is behind me. That is the Temple Bar. It was when it was down there, further down Fleet Street. It actually became too difficult for carriages to pass through it, so they had to move it up to here outside St Paul's Cathedral. But that was designed by Sir Christopher Wren, and there's a beautiful picture of Daniel Defoe, who wrote Robinson Crusoe, back in 1703, when he was put in the pillory outside this Temple Bar for seditious libel after having written a religious pamphlet. The thing was that the people liked him so much and he was so popular that they came and threw flowers. They didn't actually throw rotten eggs or anything at him. Originally it was here by the Royal Courts of Justice, but you can see now they've replaced it with that thing done by Sir Horace Jones. He's the one who designed Tower Bridge and Leadenhall Market. Daniel Defoe's name wasn't really Daniel Defoe, it was actually Daniel Foe, but he added duh in order to sound more aristocratic and posh. But that's not the only explanation for being passed from pillar to post. My other tenuous link is down near St James.
To the latest toughest scene you ever saw, let the people sing.
So here I am down in St. James, just outside the palace, over there, St. James Palace. And some people say that the expression being passed from pillar to post is actually a term used in real tennis, which was an old version of the game of tennis. And there used to be an old tennis court here, actually, and part of the furniture of a tennis court, they had lots of pillars and posts, because it was a kind of indoor thing. And yeah, if you were getting the run around by your opponent, you'd be sent over one side, over the other side to retrieve the ball, and you'd be constantly passed from pillar to post. This one existed here since 1617, and they eventually knocked it down in 1697, just before the Palace of Whitehall burnt down, and a lot of shops decided to build their businesses here. So it was just 1 year later that Berry Brothers and Rudd opened up, well, what's now a wine shop, but it used to be the coffee house, the coffee mill over there. And that's been there ever since, Berry Brothers. Amazing to think, but it used to be a real tennis court.
When things all go wrong, you will find a song. Welcome as the Red Hot Spring.
Ah, now here we are outside the Lamb and Flag pump. Built in 1623. This is the oldest pump in Covent Garden, one of my favourites. Now, have you ever heard the expression to lose your bottle? You know, if you don't have the courage to do something, like, I don't know, you're standing on the top diving board or something and someone's saying, go on, jump in, and you're like, oh no, everyone will say, he's lost his bottle, he doesn't have the courage. And my tenuous link to this pump is that in the back room here, they used to have bare knuckle fist fights, and it became known as the Bucket of Blood. Now, each fighter would have a bottle man who would provide you with water in between the rounds. And you couldn't continue a fight if you didn't have a bottle man. But sometimes this could be quite convenient, because if you were getting completely beaten up and you didn't want to continue the fight, you could conveniently ask your bottle man to go wandering off. And if he wandered off, went missing, then you'd have to just hold your hands up and say, oh, look, sorry, mate, I can't continue this fight. My bottle man's gone. I've lost my bottle man. So losing your bottle man became abbreviated to losing your bottle, losing your courage. And it was in this very alley that John Dryden, the famous poet, got beaten up by a bunch of thugs hired by the Earl of Rochester, John Wilmot. Excellent. He was the one who was played by Johnny Depp in that film, The Libertine, very highly recommended film. But some people claim that the expression losing a bottle comes from losing control of your sphincter, you know, losing control of your bum, because your bottle in Cockney rhyming slang means your ass, bottle and glass, ass. Well, actually, strictly speaking, it's Aristotle, so it's your aris. He fell over on his aris. Aristotle, bottle and glass, ass. And so if you lose control of your ass, you've lost your courage because you're quivering too much. Like at the end of a football match where Sir Alex Ferguson described the moment right at the end when you're clinging on for the victory and you're under a lot of pressure. He said, it's squeaky bum time.
And in good old London town, poor puzzled moon, he wore a frown.
Do remember, by the way, if you like these videos, to follow my Instagram channel, which is at Joolz Guides Official. My old one got deleted. Don't ask me why. It's a long story. But yeah, do please follow that. Apparently, it makes a difference and it helps. So, at Joolz Guides Official. Now, where are we heading? Berkeley Square. Now, have you ever heard anyone say they had to bite the bullet? When you bite the bullet, it means you have to do something that you really don't want to have to do, but it's absolutely necessary, so you go and do it anyway. So, for example, you might have just been through an extremely messy divorce and you really don't want to have to talk to your ex-husband or wife, but it's absolutely vital to call them because you need to discuss who is going to take custody of the much-loved record collection. So you might say, oh, well, I really didn't want to call her, but in the end, I just decided to bite the bullet and I picked up the phone. Now, the phrase was first used in English literature in 1891 by Rudyard Kipling in a story called The Light That Failed. My God, I'm blind, and the darkness will never go away. Steady, Dickie, steady, said the deep voice in his ear. Bite on the bullet, old man, and don't let them think you're afraid. Now, Rudyard Kipling lived in India, actually, and my tenuous link with this phrase is that house over there, because that's where Clive of India lived. Now, it was Clive of India who laid the foundation for British rule in India, and he actually worked for the East India Company, which was a trading company, eventually managed to boot out the French, so the British took control of the trading there and everything. And he became the first governor of the Bengal Presidency, which was the whole area all around the Bay of Bengal, quite in the northern part. out. And they say that the atrocities he carried out led to the Great Bengal Famine of 1770. And he made an absolute fortune, something like £90 million, which he brought back here to his house in Berkeley Square. Now, in the Great Indian Rebellion of 1857, also known as the Indian Mutiny, there was a much favoured gun, which was called the Enfield Rifled Musket, which had a cartridge which came with a bullet in one half and the gunpowder in the other half. And what you'd have to do is you'd pour the gunpowder down the barrel of your gun first, and then you'd have to bite the bullet in half, or almost bite the cartridge in half. And then you take the bullet part and put that down your gun. Now, a lot of Indian soldiers were serving in the British Army, and the lower ranking soldiers were given this hideous task of having to bite the bullets, bite the cartridge open. But the cartridges were often coated in pig fat or cow fat, I don't know, to keep them dry or to hold them in place or something. And this was a really abhorrent task, because it was completely against their religion to bite on this pig fat and cow fat. So they were forced to do it under duress, and hence the expression having to bite the bullet, carrying out a task that you really don't want to do. Now, some people think the expression actually precedes this and comes from the 18th century, where people talked about chewing on a bullet. In 1788, Francis Grose, who compiled the Dictionary of the Vulgar Tongue, defines something called a nightingale, who is a soldier who, when he was being punished, he'd cry out in agony. It is a point of honour in some regiments among the grenadiers never to cry out or become nightingales whilst under the discipline of the cat o' nine tails, which was like a weapon, to avoid which they chew a bullet. So to avoid crying out like a nightingale in agony, they'd bite down on a bullet. It doesn't sound like a very good idea to me. You'd probably break your teeth. Surely a piece of leather would be better. But anyway, that's what some people claim. Also, it gives me the lovely tenuous link of a nightingale singing in Berkeley Square. Now, here I am back in Deptford, and don't forget to watch my amazing Deptford video, because it's one of my favourites. Really interesting, fascinating area. And we're just back here by the statue of Tsar Peter the Great, who interestingly lived around here. But anyway, the reason I'm here is to talk about the expression, pull your finger out, man. Have you ever heard someone tell you to get a move on by saying, come on, get a move on, pull your finger out, man? It usually means pull your finger out, stop dawdling, and just get on with it. I do like Peter the Great. He's so tall. He was apparently 7 foot tall or so. Now, anyway, I was going to talk about these cannons. Well, look, these are very fancy ornate cannons, but I've heard tell one explanation of the expression pull your finger out. So when they used to use cannons in battles, there would be someone called a powder monkey, and his job was to pour powder down one of these little holes at the back of the cannon, and then usually they would use something like a cork to hold the gunpowder in place before the man comes and lights it. But in the heat of battle, when the guns are being fired right, left and centre, and there isn't much time to keep on putting a cork in, sometimes the powder monkey would just hold his finger over the gunpowder hole. When the artillery man came over to try and light the cannon, he was saying, come on, pull your finger out, man, we're in a rush here. So he'd tell you to pull your finger out of that hole so he could fire the cannon. Who knows? It might be true and it might be bollocks, but there is another tenuous link to another phrase which is often used. Have you ever heard someone say that it's cold enough to freeze the balls off a brass monkey? Well, some people claim, come down here and I'll show you, a brass monkey was the stack of cannonballs which was put onto the deck of a ship, like this one down here. Look, they would stack the cannonballs up on a tray, and in very cold weather, the water and moisture would gather around the cannonballs, and if it froze and then it melted, then that would cause the cannonballs to fall down. But I think it sounds a bit unlikely that they would stack cannonballs on a ship. In fact, there's no evidence that cannonballs were stacked on ships like that. It would be a bit of a crazy thing to do, to be honest. And even scientifically, I'm not sure if it adds up. But I quite like it, so I'm going to continue to tell people that that's what it means. But it's probably more likely that it just simply came from the actual brass monkeys, which you could buy from China and Japan as sort of souvenirs back in the 19th century. Sometimes they come covering their eyes and their ears, so see no evil, hear no evil. And I think originally they would have said things like, it's cold enough to freeze the ears off a brass monkey, or it's cold enough to freeze the nose off a brass monkey, maybe through general vulgarity that grew into being cold enough to freeze the balls off a brass monkey. Although I'm not sure whether they came furnished with balls, to be honest. I have also heard people say, pull your finger out of your ass, which could have originated in the Air Force as a rather more uncouth modern colloquialism. I think it's pretty self-explanatory though. Quite what it was doing up there in the first place, I can't tell.
See the Costa Barrows, vegetable marrows and the fruit pot high.
Cheers, Michael.
Cheers.
Thanks very much. Thanks, everyone. Thanks for watching. Don't forget to hit the subscribe button if you like these videos. It really does help, and it makes me look good. It doesn't cost anything. And above all, don't forget to come for a drink at the newly opened Albert Pub here in Primrose Hill. See you next time, folks.